Hello. I often receive comments on YouTube about super cheap adjustable DC power supplies sold on Amazon asking if they are good. So I actually bought one. Let's check it out. By super cheap adjustable DC power supplies, I meant power supplies sold on Amazon for about $50. This is my impression after using it. It properly outputs voltage. It serves the function. But you can't expect more than that. Their usability is very poor. If you are considering using this kind of power supplies at work, I don't recommend it. Purchase more reliable power supplies. There are several reliable power supply manufacturers in Japan, so I recommend buying from them. However, there's a fact that many people want to use inexpensive power supplies for their hobby, not for work. The reality is that a proper power supply is quite expensive. I have several power supplies to use on my videos. This is a linear power supply. I remember that it cost around $400 or $500. The one below is a Japanese switching power supply that can output up to about 1,600 watts. If you buy a new one, it costs around $2,600. These proper power supplies are quite expensive, so you may hesitate if you only want one for your hobby. That's why I decided to review this super cheap power supply sold on Amazon today. Before buying a power supply, you need to know the differences between linear power supplies and switching power supplies. Linear power supplies tend to be more expensive, but they produce less noise. Switching power supplies are quite cheap, but they produce more noise. Most extremely cheap adjustable DC power supplies sold on Amazon are switching power supplies. I don't think there are any super cheap linear power supplies. This is the super cheap adjustable DC power supply I bought. It was about $45. It's also a switching power supply. Let's actually use it. There is a power socket at the back. When you plug it in here, it powers on. Can you see the light? I found the first downside. The main power switch is located at the back, which is really inconvenient to use. This power supply does not have an output button. The main power button at the back serves the role of an output button as well. This means that as soon as this power supply is turned on, voltage will be coming from the output terminals. If you leave the voltage settings as they are when you finish an experiment, next time when you start a new experiment, a high voltage might be output. It could lead to damage to the power supply. So you need to set the voltage to 0 volt every time before turning off the power. It's such a hassle. This is a typical power supply. It has a main power button on the front and it has a separate output button. It's a common configuration of a power supply. If you want to use a super cheap power supply like this one, with the main power button serving as the output button, you need to be prepared for inconvenience. Next downside is the constant current mode. It's a function to prevent excessive current flow and is commonly provided by adjustable DC power supplies. You can set the amount of current to flow during constant current mode, but the way to set it is a bit inconvenient. How is it inconvenient? You have to short circuit the output to specify the current value. The display shows whether it's in the constant voltage mode or constant current mode. In order to specify the current value, you need to short circuit and change the mode to CC mode or constant current mode. It's somewhat inconvenient, isn't it? You have to short circuit every time. Many other power supplies, like this one, have a function in which you can specify the short circuit current value without having the power supply output any current. Next downside I will introduce is what I think is the worst part of this extremely cheap power supply. As you turn the voltage adjustment knob, the voltage increases. In the case of this power supply, the voltage increases when you turn this knob. Then, what happens to the voltage when you turn the knob in the opposite direction? I'm turning the knob, but the voltage doesn't decrease so much. I'll try one more time. When you increase the voltage, the response is very good, as you can see. However, when you try to decrease the voltage, I've turned the knob to the end just now. However, the voltage hasn't decreased so much. It took about 15 seconds for the voltage to reach 0 volt. This happens when there's almost no load. This is not only inconvenient, but also simply dangerous. When you decrease the voltage cannot be decreased immediately to the specified value. Also, the voltage will remain in the output terminal for about 10 to 20 seconds. I wouldn't say this is totally unusable, but I don't really want to use it. For this issue, there's a makeshift solution. It's to connect a resistor in parallel to the output. Let me explain. I haven't disassembled the power supply, but I imagine the diagram looks like this. These are the output terminals, positive and negative. This is a large capacity electrolytic capacitor. A discharge resistor is connected in parallel. I imagine the circuit looks like this. Adjustable DC power supplies have a large capacity electrolytic capacitor in the output section. The problem with this super cheap power supply is that when you decrease the voltage, the electric charge is discharged from the electrolytic capacitor slowly, leaving voltage for a long time. Let's see how the voltage changes. We can see that it rises instantly when you turn the knob to increase the voltage. Now, let's try lowering the voltage. I turn the knob all the way, but the voltage decreases pretty slowly. This looks exactly like the discharge curve of a capacitor or a resistor. See? This may not be the case for super cheap adjustable power supplies like this one, but typically adjustable DC power supplies have a discharge circuit to discharge the electrolytic capacitor quickly, so that the output voltage decreases quickly. Usually the circuit looks like this. A discharge circuit continuously draws a constant current using a transistor and a shunt resistor. A discharge circuit increases the cost, so it's unlikely that it's used in cheap power supplies like this one. You can find various types of cheap stabilized power supplies on Amazon. I can't say this for sure since I haven't disassembled other cheap power supplies, but if it's cheap, even if it looks different, I imagine the internal circuits are basically the same as this power supply. In other words, there is hardly any functional difference between any cheap power supplies. So when you choose a cheap power supply, decide which one to purchase based solely on its user interface. So that was my review of the visible part of the power supply. Next, I'm going to use the oscilloscope to look at the switching noise and the output voltage. As I explained earlier, since this is a switching power supply, there should be some level of noise. I will check the voltage right after coming out of the power supply. I'll flow 2.5 amps, which is half of the rated current. It would be convenient if I could easily adjust the CC mode settings, but you can't do that with this power supply as I explained earlier. This is the waveform of the switching noise. Since this part and this part are about 15 microseconds apart, the switching frequency is 70 kHz. The amplitude of the noise is about 200 millivolts. This power supply is not suitable for experiments that use circuits susceptible to noise or AD conversion. I believe people who know well about power supplies wouldn't use this kind of power supplies for such purposes. This is high frequency noise due to switching, but you can also see these low frequency ripples as well. Since it's a cheap power supply, it may be better not to get too much concerned about noises. Next, I'd like to see how quickly the voltage recovers when a load is suddenly connected to the power supply. I'll connect this resistor just for a moment. I'll give it a try. The waveform looks like this. Let's zoom in a little. When the load is connected, the voltage drops sharply. However, there is a capacitor in the power supply, so the voltage does not drop that much. After that, the feedback control of the power supply works and tries to return the power supply voltage to its original state. So the voltage rises. It returns to the original power supply voltage in about 3 milliseconds. That's the voltage response of this power supply. It's not bad. When you take a close look, you realize that it hasn't returned to the original voltage even after enough time has passed. It seems the voltage has slightly dropped permanently. Let's check this with a voltmeter. First, I'll adjust the voltage without connecting any load. Let's set it to around 20 volts. It's exactly 20 volts. It's 20 volts without any load. Now, what happens when you connect a load? It seems there is a permanent voltage drop. It became 19.97 volts, a voltage drop of about 30 millivolts, a voltage drop of 30 millivolts at 2.5 amps. I think this is quite good for the price. I'll check how accurate the displayed voltage is. There's a difference. I have prepared a relatively accurate voltmeter here. There is a difference of about 50 millivolts between the displayed voltages. This power supply can apparently output up to 300 watts at 60 volts, 5 amperes. I'll check if it can really output 300 watts. I will use this electronic load. Let's gradually increase the flowing current. Currently, 1 amp is flowing and the power consumption is 60 watts. I will increase the current further. I'll increase it to 4 amps all at once. A current of 4 amps is flowing now, but the power supply is experiencing a slight voltage drop. When no load is applied, the voltage is 61 volts. But when a current starts to flow, the voltage drops quite a bit. Now, a rated current of 5 amps is flowing. The output voltage of the power supply has dropped to 56 volts. It means the output power is only about 280 watts. Therefore, the description on the specification that said 300 watts, 60 volts, 5 amps on was not accurate. Also, the output voltage is not very stable. I'll try to see how much current it can handle. 5.1 amps. It's still okay. 5.2. 5.2 is too much. It switched to the CC mode. The power supply started to smell. I need to stop here because it's dangerous. I'll stop pushing it to the limit. After that, I decided to perform a full load test for about 10 minutes. I didn't hear any strange noises from inside, no noises such as bursting noise. Therefore, there are no particular problems in terms of quality. There is a cooling fan on the back of the main unit, but it doesn't run constantly. Looks like it runs when the internal temperature rises. So that was my general review on functions. It's a super cheap adjustable DC power supply, so I don't have high expectations. It works. I don't see any problems. Next, I'll disassemble it and take a look inside. This is the inside of the power supply. I think this is a common configuration of switching power supplies. An aluminum plate is used on the backside, which serves as a heat sink. There is a diode at the edge of the heat sink. The forward voltage across this diode controls the cooling fan. There are resistors connected in parallel with the capacitors. These are the discharge resistors I mentioned earlier. To speed up the discharge, the resistance needs to be a little smaller, but if you make it too small, the power consumption in this part will increase. So it's not really a good idea. That is why a better power supply has a discharge circuit in addition to the discharge resistors. There are shunt resistors for detecting current here. These shunt resistors look like copper wires. I did some reverse engineering. This is the circuit of the power supply. I've omitted the filter circuit, but this diagram is mostly true to the actual thing. I don't think I've ever seen a circuit like this one. It's a circuit that you don't often come across. It looks like an LLC converter circuit, but it's a bit different. It's a bit different from a forward converter either. So far, I've been disassembling and analyzing the power supply. To summarize, even though there are issues, which includes the output voltage decreasing slowly, this power supply is not so bad if you don't try to use it in an intense way. Aside from this one, there are many other cheap adjustable DC power supplies on Amazon. I'll review the appearance of such power supplies. The one I bought for this video is this Amazon's Choice product. There are various cheap power supplies, but I think the inner structure is basically all the same. So when you choose a power supply, I recommend choosing based on the user interface. Preferable power supplies are the ones with the main power button and output button on the front side. For example, this one has the power and output buttons on the front side. It looks fine. And this one as well. This one also has the main power button and output button on the front side. I recommend to choose a power supply like this. But just to remind you, I haven't checked the structure inside. In the description, I attached the links of the power supplies that seem easy to use. Check them out if you're interested. I cannot guarantee the quality though. I chose them based solely on the usability of the exterior. If this video was helpful, please comment, like, and subscribe to the channel. Thank you for watching.